JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for March the 18th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, today I will explain why EU and US equity markets rebounded yesterday, but I will also explain why the Asian indices pulled back today. I will say why the dollar was the main 10 gainer, and why NOK and CAD were the main losers. Now, as for today's events, we have the Eurozone final CPIs, the US building permits and housing starts, Canada CPIs, the Energy Information Administration weekly report on crude oil, while tonight we get Australia's employment report and New Zealand's GDP. As always, let's start with the performance of the greenback. The dollar traded higher against all of the other G10 currencies on Tuesday, and during the Asian morning Wednesday, it gained the most versus NOK, CAD and Aussie in that order. While it gained the least versus the yen and the Swiss franc. So the relative strength of the yen and the franc suggests a risk of trading, while the slide in the krone and the loonie suggests that oil prices kept tumbling. Now, although the latter is correct, the former conclusion is not that right. Yes, most Asian bourses closed in the red today, but major EU and US indices were a sea of green yesterday. European shares were boosted by Spanish Prime Minister's announcement with regards to a 200 billion euro stimulus package. You can see that the IBEX 35 index surged the most, 6.46%, while in the US Wall Street indices rallied as the Fed and the White House proceeded with further measures in order to inject more liquidity and ease the effects of the fast-spreading coronavirus. You can see that all the Dow, the S&P and the Nasdaq, all three of Wall Street indices rallied. Specifically, the FOMC decided to purchase short-term corporate bonds in an attempt to help companies to keep paying their employees and buy supplies, and this comes after several rescue attempts by the Fed, including the latest 100 basis points rate cut and the decision to restart US Treasury purchases. Now, with regards to the government's measures, the White House announced it is seeking a stimulus package worth between $815 billion and $1 trillion. In detail, potentially the $250 billion will be directed to Americans via checks, and this could happen in the next couple of weeks. So, having said all that, though, the joy in the equity markets did not last for long, as we saw. Let's see again the equity performance. You can see that Asian indices turned south, and the reason may have been once again that the fact that the virus continues to spread at a fast pace. From the graphs here, we can see that both cases and deaths returned into acceleration mode yesterday. Remember, anything above 0 points to acceleration, anything below 0 points to slowdown. So we had accelerating death and cases. While in absolute numbers, we had daily records. Namely, on Tuesday, we had 15 1,740 new cases and 817 new deaths. You can see a graph of the day-by-day change in absolute numbers here, and you can see that cases hit a new record peak. Now, as for our view, we stick to our guns that consumers are unlikely to opt for cheap loans and get out of their homes to start spending. And with the virus spreading around the globe at an exponential pace, even with helicopter money, people may prefer to stay home and save the money, perhaps considering it as a compensation for their lost salaries. Thus, we don't expect the latest bounce in equities to continue. It was even halted during the Asian morning today. Since February 20th, we rarely saw two consecutive days of gains in the equity markets, and all the aforementioned suggests that we have not hit a bottom yet, especially with no virus vaccine on the horizon. Now, in case the opposite happens, where people and businesses start spending, this could lead to a sharp rise in inflation, which would put central banks between a rock and a hard place. Their dilemma will be, do we increase rates to avoid hyperinflation, or do we keep them low in order to save our battered economies from falling into recession? In our view, with more central banks cutting rates aggressively at the moment, we believe that they are either not prepared for such an outcome, or they just decided that they will prioritize saving growth over curbing inflation. Now back to the currencies. The dollar was the main gainer, as we saw at the beginning of our video, and may have benefited from the White House announcement, but also because investors are liquidating positions everywhere in favor of holding cash. Remember, yesterday we noted that even gold, which is usually considered a safe haven, has been in a tumbling mode as holders of the precious metal liquidate their long positions to cover losses and margin calls elsewhere. The Norwegian krone and the Canadian dollar have been the main losers among the G10s, and this may have been due to the tumbling oil prices. Both Brent and WTI fell 4.03% and 6.17% respectively yesterday on fears that the restrictive measures adopted for fighting the coronavirus will hurt energy in demand even further, as well as due to the price war that has broken after the collapse of an agreement between OPEC and major non-OPEC members to curb supply further. Iraq's oil minister called for an emergency meeting between producers in order to discuss immediate action for balancing the market, but the hard stance of Saudi Arabia and Russia makes the case of finding common ground anytime soon a very hard task. This means that with what we have in hand now, oil prices are likely to keep falling, dragging the loonie and the krone with them. You can see the correlation between dollar CAD and WTI here. WTI is inverted, and you can see that while oil prices have been falling, USD CAD has been surging. So if oil prices continue their downtrend, I would expect dollar CAD to continue its uptrend. Now, as for today's events, under normal circumstances, we would have had an FOMC policy decision, but following the 100 basis points cut late Sunday, early Monday, Fed Chair Powell announced that the committee will not proceed with this week's scheduled meeting. The same may apply for the Bank of Japan's gathering during the Asian morning Thursday. Now, as for the data, during the European morning today, we get Eurozone's final CPIs for February, and as it is always the case, they are expected to confirm their preliminary estimates, namely that the headline rate slid 1.2% year over year from 1.4%, while the core rate ticked up to 1.2% from 1.1%. So, given that the expectation is for confirming what we already know, I don't expect the euro to react much on this release. From the US, we get building permits and housing starts for February, with the forecasts suggesting small declines, while from Canada we have the CPIs for February. The headline CPI is anticipated to have slowed to 2.1% from 2.4%, while no forecast is available for the core rate, which stood at 1.8% year over year in January. Now, under normal circumstances, these would have allowed the Bank of Canada policymakers to stay away from the cut button, but bearing in mind that central banks are now acting to support the wounded global economy that is hit by the effects of the coronavirus outbreak, we cannot rule out another bold action by the Bank of Canada, even perhaps outside a scheduled meeting. With regards to the energy market, the Energy Information Administration report on crude oil inventories is coming out, and the forecast points to 1.9 barrels slide from a 6.4 million barrels decrease the week before. However, bearing in mind that the American Petroleum Institute report yesterday revealed a much smaller slide, we see the risks surrounding the Energy Information Administration forecast as tilted to the upside. Now, as for tonight and during the Asian morning Thursday, we have Australia's employment report for February. The unemployment rate is expected to have stayed unchanged at 5.3%, well above the 4.5% threshold which the RBA believes it will start generating inflationary pressures, while the employment change is forecast to show that the economy has gained less job than it did in January. Specifically, it is expected to reveal 10,000 new jobs, down from 13,500 in January. Now, at their latest meeting, RBA officials decided to cut interest rates by 25 basis points to a new record low of 0.5%, with Governor Philip Lowe saying in the post-meeting statement that the coronavirus was having a significant impact on the domestic economy and that it's hard to assess how large the effects will be. In the statement, it was also repeated that officials remain prepared to ease monetary policy further to support the Australian economy. According to the ASX 30-day interbank cash rate futures yield curve, investors expect officials to push the cut button again at the April meeting, and a soft employment report may just seal the deal. New Zealand's GDP for the fourth quarter is also due to be released. The forecast is for the quarter-over-quarter rate to have declined to 0.5% from 0.7%, but this will drive the year-over-year rate up to 2.4% from 2.3%. With all other major central banks easing their policy in order to safeguard the global economy from the coronavirus crisis, the RBNZ was no exception, kickstarting this week's easing chorus with an emergency 75 basis points rate reduction, noting that the economic outlook has deteriorated significantly. Officials also added that the rate will stay at 0.25% at least for 12 months, meaning that there are no more cuts on the horizon. That said, they agreed that should further stimulus be required, a large-scale asset purchase program would be preferable. With all that in mind, we don't believe that data referring to a period before the virus outbreak would alter that view, and thus they may not prove the market mover they usually are. We prefer to wait for data concerning the first quarter of 2020, as these numbers may prove determinant over whether the RBNZ will proceed with quantitative easing. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock a.m. GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So, goodbye, have a great day, and I hope I see you again here tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.